road infrastructure development, job creation, and national economic growth is very germane, as it provides the opportunity to deliberate on various options available for financing our numerous road infrastructure projects while engaging our youth and boosting economic activities. The Budget Office of the Federation recognizes the strong positive correlation between a country's economic development and the quality of its road network. The United States President John F. Kennedy was famously quoted as saying, "American roads are not good because America is rich, but America is rich because American roads are good." This quote from the 1960s implies that no country can become buoyant economically without good road infrastructure. Reducing the distance between people, markets, services, and knowledge, or simply getting people connected, is mainly what economic growth is all about. In spite of the increasing importance of virtual connectivity, a good and reliable road transport network remains vital. As you are aware, the design, construction, operation, and maintenance of road projects has great potentials for job creation and acceleration of growth performance. Several jobs can be created among skilled and semi-skilled persons through the production of modern road furniture and labor-intensive methods of road infrastructure development. Other benefits of road construction and rehabilitation include increased agricultural productivity and food security through easy evacuation of farm produce to markets across the country. Lower vehicle operating costs, transport costs, and travel times along routes that were hitherto difficult to traverse. Strengthening the local economy by enhancing access to market for local produce and access to health facilities. And safe commuting and reduction in traffic-related fatalities. In recognition of the importance of a well-developed road infrastructure, the government, the federal government, over time has invested substantially in roads, creating a network that was once considered to be the best in Africa. Nigeria relies heavily on road transport for movement of goods and persons. However, the percentage of the road network in good condition appears over time to have declined due likely to funding constraints. The current state of many of the federal roads, measuring about 37,000 kilometers, is due to the inadequate resources available to complete and or maintain them. State slash local government roads are even in far worse conditions generally. Traditionally, road and bridge infrastructure projects have been financed through public resources, mainly domestic revenues, for example, taxation, domestic borrowing, external borrowings, and grants like aid. The Buhari administration resolved to commit at least 30% of the total annual budget to capital projects, a target we are yet to meet consistently. Accordingly, government has made significant investment on roads. Capital allocations to the Federal Ministry of Works and Housing was increased by 50.7% from 288.84 billion naira in the revised 2020 budget to 435.32 billion naira in the proposed 2021 budget. It is also noteworthy that through the initiatives like the Presidential Infrastructure Development Fund and the Road Trust Fund, there are additional funds available to the road sector. However, available funding for road infrastructure from traditional sources still falls far short of the required investment. In the past few years, the federal government has been diversifying its borrowing instruments with the introduction of the Sukuk green bonds and diaspora bonds. Okay. Additional funding mechanisms have been explored, like the Presidential Infrastructure Development Fund and the Road Trust Fund, which is a tax credit scheme. But in view of the currently constrained fiscal space, it is imperative to explore alternative road infrastructure financing options. We cannot continue to do the same thing year in, year out, and expect different results. Across the globe, the road infrastructure financing landscape is changing. Governments are under severe economic pressure and are finding it difficult to fund road infrastructure projects. We should therefore look to learn from what is working in some other climes. I would therefore like to leave this council with a few thoughts to ponder. One, in the face of severe resource constraints, what can we do to make public road construction projects more cost efficient? Two, what sort of balance should we have between allocation of limited funds to new construction and maintenance of existing infrastructure annually? Three, what will it take to create strong Nigerian companies in the road construction sector in the mold of Arab contractors in Egypt? I believe this is an essential step in driving down our construction costs. Four, what will it take to break down the lingering resistance to delivery of road infrastructure through public-private partnerships, PPPs, in Nigeria? Five, at the minimum, should we not retoll all the federal roads that were previously tolled until the Obasanjo administration pulled down the toll gates? Six, is it not the time to revisit the National Road Fund, which has been under consideration in Nigeria since 1998, along the lines of the Highway Trust Fund, which finances most federal government highway projects in the United States, America? Seven, do we not need an effective independent regulator for the road sector that will set and enforce standards for construction and usage of road infrastructure? Eight, what role is there for relevant professional bodies whose members are often complicit in the poor execution of some road projects, of some government road projects? I wish you fruitful deliberations and hope that this will not be another mere talk show, as we are becoming repeated for.
Let me start by saying that when Governor Wike asked me to use his podium, I became very suspicious. Because when he came in this morning, he was dressed like Governor Otom of Benue. So I asked him, why are you trying to disguise? You think I won't know you? But really, he has an amazing sense of humor. And I want to thank him very much on behalf of all of us in the Federal Ministry of Works and Housing for accepting to host this 2020 edition of the National Council of Works. Indeed, the commitment to host this event was made since last year in December, when Cross River State hosted the 25th edition. At the time that Governor Wike asked his commissioner to convey their decision to host this event, nobody foresaw the outbreak of a devastating viral epidemic like COVID-19. But let me quickly say something about that. The One of the lessons it has perhaps driven home, we all knew it, but COVID perhaps has driven it home more forcefully, that the entire global economy is dependent on one thing, human mobility. If people don't move, there is no economy. So it is in that context also that we are discussing about roads and about how they contribute to economic growth. When people are on the move, money is being made. And the process to even get them on the move is also a worthy process for making money. And let me say that very, very sensible states and counties and local government also host seminars like this because it is good business for the community. If we were not here today, there won't be so many cameras, there won't be so much water, there won't be so many young people dressed up like this, there won't be multimedia, this musician and his equipment will be lying idle at home. This is how some cities and countries across the world have become famous only for summits, for conferences, and this is a good thing to emulate by the government that has decided to host us here. Now, I need to be very careful as I commend the government of Rivers State, because you never know where Governor Wike stands. He never leaves his development too far away from his politics. You know, a few weeks ago I was here, and to commission one of his bridges as part of a very, very worthy, ambitious, and commendable urban renewal program. And he said a lot of nice things about the Muhammadu Buhari government, especially because money was coming. And 48 hours later, somebody called me, can you see what Wike is saying? He said, APC has not done anything for Nigeria. I said, maybe the money has not come. Well, he's my very good friend. He doesn't leave his politics too far from his development. But truth be told, COVID came. We needed to respond. The federal government set up a task force. And I must say that we are not out of the woods in terms of combating the disease, and all of us still need to be at our utmost vigilance. But one of the things that came out from COVID was an economic sustainability plan, a plan that challenged ministries, departments, and agencies of government to see something that they could do in order to drive, keep the economy going, keep and sustain growth. So it was in that context that we thought that this year's council theme should be road infrastructure development, job creation, and national economic growth. The whole world essentially is in recession. So let nobody fool you. Whether it is the biggest economy in the world or the second biggest, or the EU countries, they're either printing money or borrowing money and just throwing money at the problem. And our country is not different in trying to find solutions that will work. We have had a recession that was foretold. The interesting and perhaps positive thing in the negative thing is that the depth of the recession was much shallower than was foretold. So it's like a doctor who prescribes or foresees a condition and prescribes a solution. And you will see that from -6%, we are now in Q2, we are now in -3% in Q3. And that is almost a 50% gain, even still in the negative. If that run rate continues, then for Q4, we might just about plateau back to zero or a little over that. But in that period, we understood that the urban poor were hard hit as a result of necessary lockdowns. And this is the connection between mobility and the economy. As we locked down, people's jobs and incomes and livelihoods were also affected. So at that period of lockdown, nobody could come here to host this kind of event. And government had to think, what can we do differently? So as the ease of lockdown started, one of the two sectors that government first announced was agri for food and nutrition, to start planting for next season because we had consumed a lot of our reserves. And you cannot easily now divorce even high food prices from high demand at the peak of the pandemic. And your basic economics will tell you that when demand really ratchets up, price follows it. Of course, there are other factors. So, and until all of that is replaced, we may not see the best prices as going. But what is instructive then is that working with the various state governors, we were able to resume work in 26 states in May. And this was the way to start redistributing wealth again, because that's what infrastructure really does, as I will attempt to just highlight. And FEMA, our maintenance agency, was also able to resume work in 92 different locations in 24 states. These were strategic responses to get the economy back on track. And one of the other things we did was to try to increase the component of local content. And I think one or two of the speakers before me have spoken to the contributory factor of bitumen and all of that. But two things are instructive here. We decided first to do more labor-intensive road work using stone and local content-intensive using cement, concrete, and those things that we did not need to import. And I am happy to announce that those policies are already having impact. We developed safety guidelines, so this may have been unknown to people. We developed safety guidelines in the Ministry of Works for all our contractors, how to clean equipment, how to decontaminate them, how to social distance on construction site, how to change how people were supplied food at construction. All of this was going on in Nigeria, and they eventually have started yielding some results. So some of the results that have come out is the third quarter GDP, even though still negative, as I said, minus 3% is 50% better than what it was in quarter two. But I just like to share with you that sectors such as quarrying, which supports construction, grew in that quarter by 41.81%. from a negative position when work stopped. Cement manufacturing also grew by 11.96%. And construction as a full sector of its own grew by 2.64%. With more work being done now, we are looking at what the quarter four results will be, especially now we are in the full glow of dry weather. So there is clearly a strong indication of recovery from just infrastructure contribution alone. And regarding the use of more cement and more stone and more concrete, we discovered that the design manual in the country was only for flexible pavement, which is our asphalt and bituminous base road. And we needed to develop a design manual for rigid pavement. I am also happy to now report that COVID experience has challenged us to do this as a solution. And we have now produced a manual under the leadership of my colleague, the Honorable Minister of State for Works and Housing, who I believe is with us virtually, and the Director of Bridges and Design, Engineer Emmanuel Adu, is he in the house? Let him just stand up and take a bow. He led the team, and they have produced that design manual for rigid pavement for the country in consultation with all the stakeholders. And there's no better place to unveil this manual than at this annual Council of Works on Roads. I believe that there is a copy each for each state government, and Engineer Adeoye will make sure that you get a copy before you leave. Well, I hope that as we all go back, this manual will help us also contribute in our various states the labor-intensive, cement-intensive, stone-intensive road construction, especially for rural and state roads, where they are applicable. And to say that it is impossible to discuss roads, really, and economic development without discussing things like capital appreciation. Our studies show that every time you build a road, the adjoining land and properties around it appreciate by up to 30 to 40%. That is wealth immediately in people's pocket. So when the president says that it is possible to actually lift 100 million people out of poverty, this is already happening. It's not necessarily only by employing people. It's by creating wealth, because that value, that house, or land that appreciates by 40% means that if you want to use it to borrow money, the amount you can leverage for a loan is higher. If you have tenants there, certainly their rent will go up, and that is money in the pocket of the owner. Of course, the supply chain of food, lubricants, construction materials, such as laterite cement, reinforcement, water, energy, such as diesel, is also positively affected by infrastructure. Just last week, one of our contractors told me that just by releasing money to them in quarter three to go back to work, he was able to pay his suppliers of diesel 500 million naira, one construction company. They were owing them 850 million, but he could pay 500 million naira. Even though they haven't fully paid, what it does to the supplier is to reignite again credit supply. And then that money begins to move through. And of course, delivering 500 million naira worth of diesel means drivers, trucks, and so on and so forth. And these are parts of the economy that infrastructure touches without us perhaps being fully mindful of it. Of course, the sub-speciality of subcontractors who do lane marking, highway signage, installation of hydraulics, plumbing, and so on and so forth, even FRSC benefits from it because they now produce most of our signage, road signage. So this is just a tip of the iceberg of how far the infrastructure spend that comes from either the state governor or the federal government actually reaches. When you follow the money off the street, it ends up in very interesting places in the night where they do point and kill and so on and so forth. But the economy moves until it reaches the market, because to get point and kill, also you must go to where the fish is caught and so on and so forth. So our collective spending, which is the point I want to make, is that our collective spending, state and local federal government, will contribute in no small way at all to our recovery from recession. And it will prepare what I call inclusive and beneficial growth. In closing my speech, please permit me to highlight some of the challenges that we still encounter in some states and communities. And one of them is the issue of compensation. I am sure that you have received letters from our ministry about decisions taken to seek your cooperation to lead the resolution of compensation issues from your state. Those figures we have sent to you are the results of what our consultants give us. They are certainly not what we expect you to be bound by. You know your communities better. You know your people better. They voted for you. And we just expect to get the right of way at the most effective economic circumstances so that our contractors can continue to do their work. We're also getting feedback that in the quest for legitimate generation of internal revenue, some of the states that provide laterite and mining have hiked their fees. What this does to the contract cost is to further compound it. So wherever you can give us accommodation in all of those places, please let us finish as quickly as we can and get out. Let me conclude by sharing with you a suggestion from one of our colleagues, the Honorable Commissioner for Works and Transportation in Kwara State. I don't know if he's here because I met with him last week when I was in Ilorin, and he was suggesting that perhaps we should have a periodic meeting where the federal government and the ministers and the commissioners of the states meet more frequently rather than an annual council. He was referring to something analogous to the monthly FARC meeting. But this may not necessarily be monthly, it may be quarterly. And I thought that, well, since it wasn't an idea that I was opposed to, I will bring it to the council for the members of the council to consider. So, and I will be too happy at this point. I see that it seems that Governor Wike is enamored of this idea. So I will ask his commissioner, who is hosting us, to lead the debate amongst his colleagues and let us know at the end of this council whether it is something that we can incorporate as a resolution into our conclusions. Thank you very much for your attention.
Let me start by welcoming all of you to National Council of Works holding in Port Harcourt today. And let me also bring you greetings from the National Assembly, in particular, the Senate of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. I bring you good wishes. And also our warm regards to all of you. The theme of the conference is road infrastructure, development, job creation, and national economic growth. This is very apt and timely because our economy is gradually recovering from recession arising from the COVID-19 pandemic, which necessitated the lockdown of the economy for a very long time. This is the time the government should embark on massive infrastructural development to create jobs, accelerate economic development, and facilitate movement of goods and people nationwide. It is in realization of this that I want to commend the federal government under the leadership of President Muhammadu Buhari for initiating various funding mechanism for road construction and rehabilitation. Number one, the continuation of tax credit scheme, which was started in 2019 after signing executive order on road infrastructure development and refurbishment, investment tax credit scheme. The continuation of this scheme demonstrated the federal government commitment in improving road infrastructure. I implore manufacturers and interested stakeholders to key in on the Road Infrastructure Development Executive Order and utilize this unique opportunity in ensuring Nigeria's economic growth and consolidating on public private partnership in the country. The scheme is reflective of government desire to partner with the private sector to mobilize capital for infrastructure development. The Ministry of Works come up with the Highway Development and Management Initiative to manage and develop the national road networks to attract sustainable investment and funding in the development of road infrastructure. The private sector is eventually expected to take over the construction, rehabilitation, and management of selected roads in the country. In June 2020, the federal government raised over 162 billion naira in the stock market, codenamed Scoop Bond, to finance the construction and the rehabilitation of 44 selected roads across the 6 geopolitical zone of this country. This effort will invariably lead to increased employment and economic development across the country. We have presidential initiative on infrastructure development, where the National Sovereign Investment Authority and Recovered Loop are channeled into three legacy projects, namely Abuja, Kaduna, Zaria, Kano Road. Then we have the Lagos-Ibadan Expressway, and lastly, the second Niger Bridge. All the above efforts are meant to complement the budgetary provisions, which is grossly inadequate, hence the need to find alternative funding of road sector. Going by budgetary provision alone, there is no way government can fund 711 roads that are underfunding in our budget. So it is necessary for us to look for alternative funding. Your Excellency, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, it is a well-known fact that the cost of road construction in Nigeria is one of the highest in Africa because of the importation of bitumen and other construction equipment or materials. It is now imperative for us to look inward and find ways of reducing the cost of construction. Let me at this juncture also commend the effort of various state governments that have undertaken the construction of roads meant for federal government. And I implore state governors, ably represented by their various commissioners here, to continue this good work, because that is the only way our roads will be in good shape. What is important is that the road should be good. It doesn't matter who constructs it. When I was governor 20 years ago, I was the first governor to construct roads that are meant for federal government. And I didn't even know that I would get to the fund. And I started the entire project. And luckily, the then president, Brother Obasanjo, obliged me and paid all the money I used to construct or reconstruct the federal roads. Only 2 weeks ago, the Senate of the Federal Republic of Nigeria approved well over 120 billion naira as a refund to the Rivers State government. And I urge commissioners to convince their governors to emulate the worthy example of what the governor of Rivers State did. This is the only way we can develop road infrastructure in the country. It is also advisable to ensure more competitive bidding of road projects when it comes to procurement, with the view to save the money for other competing projects. At the same time, we should look for alternative, durable, cost-effective materials for construction locally. Lastly, we should ensure prompt and payment of contractors. And this will reduce cost of construction as contractors resort to borrowing of at higher cost from banks, which they normally pass to the federal government. On the issue of funding, as I said earlier, we have 711 road projects in the country. And we have only about 360 billion naira to fund these road projects. The only way out is to establish an infrastructure bank where funds can be borrowed and channeled into construction of these roads. We need close to about 10 trillion naira to rehabilitate or reconstruct all the federal roads in the country. And they keep on increasing. And there is no way we can get this money. So this is food for thought for all of us. I wish you very fruitful deliberations and successful journey back to your various destinations. Thank you very much.
Before I make my speech, let me correct the statement made by Senator Adamu Aleru that they refunded us 120 billion. No. No. For record purposes, what they said they will refund us is 78.9 billion. So they did not even say they will pay us. They said they will refund us 78.9. We have not seen it on the road. So it's not 120 billion. Before you know it now, my opponents in the other side, that will be the front page. Again, let me say that what the Minister of Works and Housing said, that when he came some weeks ago, I praised Mr. President, and then in the next 48 hours, somebody called his attention. That is not the same week. He said, well, maybe the money has not come. First of all, when a debtor has agreed to pay you his debt, won't you be happy? You are owing us money. I want to pay me back my money. So why should I say that you have done so much? It's the debt you are owing me. So thank you, but even though you have not paid, so I will continue to cry until you get me and you pay me my money. Let me, I wish you on behalf of the government and people of River State, warmly welcome you all to Port Harcourt for the 26th meeting of the National Council on Works. I heard that this meeting started on the 7th of December, 2020, which means that those of you who have been here since then would have been enjoying the traditional river's hospitality. We are highly honored as a state to host this meeting, which has brought together the Minister for Works and Housing, the Senate Committee Chairman of Works, the Permanent Secretary of the Minister of Works, and the Commission of Works, and the Permanent Secretary of the Ministries of Works from the 36 states of the Federation and the Federal Capital Territory, as well as other distinguished delegates and stakeholders. Ours is to welcome you, ensure your comfort, and make your stay memorable. The theme of the meeting, infrastructure development, job creation, and national economic growth, fits to the generally held view that road infrastructure plays a critical role in enabling economic development, poverty reduction, and inclusive progress. And because most developed countries understand the critical link between transport infrastructure and economic advancement, they have successfully built their economic prosperity on the back of investing in adequate and modern transport infrastructure. Nigeria is not and cannot be an exception if we are serious about realizing our basic development goals and make life more meaningful for our people. As a developing country, therefore, we need to invest twice as much as hard to put in place efficient transport infrastructure to drive our social and economic development on a sustainable basis. Since roads and other alternative transport systems are hardly available or still in the elementary stages of development, the nation must continue to develop its road infrastructure to interconnect and promote trade, facilitate movement of goods and services, spread economic opportunities to all parts of the country, as well as drive regional economic integration. This is more so. One road infrastructure alone presently accounts for over 90% of all freights and passenger movements across the country and will remain so for a long time to come. However, despite having the largest road network in Africa, Nigeria's available national road networks, currently estimated to be eligible at 1,000 kilometers, are grossly inadequate to drive economic growth at the rate and scale we deserve. This means that we need to do much more to accelerate road infrastructure delivery to catalyze economic growth and support our rapidly expanding population and urban life. The federal government appears overwhelmed with the construction and provision of too many road projects across the country, which is a good thing, by the way. But it would have been better for the federal government to complete most of the ongoing roads before embarking on new ones and stop the negative culture of spreading available resources too little across several road projects without achieving any tangible results several years after construction started. The East-West Road, which is too important to the economic prosperity of the South-South region and the nation, has been under construction over 15 years, yet a completion date is still not in sight. This is not progress, except we want to keep pretending about our incompetence and lack of seriousness with our development. I appeal to the federal government to include the East-West Road among the critical infrastructural projects being funded from the coffers of the National Sovereign Wealth Fund to guarantee its completion by 2021, as being taunted by the Minister of the Niger Delta. I also believe the federal government's directive stopping state governments from funding the construction or rehabilitation of failed federal roads is inimical to the effective development, management, and maintenance of road infrastructure across the country. Failed, broken, or deteriorated federal roads, if not promptly fixed, will upset economic growth in affected states and challenge the well-being of citizens. It makes progress sense as a development strategy, therefore, for state governments to reconstruct such federal roads with reputable contractors on behalf of the federal government and get refunded after due verification of the price and quality of work done. I was talking to the minister and I said, the directive that states should not touch federal government roads will not only affect the economic activities in those various states, but again will affect the citizens. The suffering will be too much. So our own suggestion is that, yes, you can go ahead, but we'll look at what you have done, which company is doing it, what are the prices that you have given, and then we'll come together to say, okay, we don't have money now, we'll refund you in the future. But the issue that we shall abandon federal roads, if you do it, it is at your own cost. That would not be good for the interest and the development of the states. Now, I don't know how many states today can use Julius Berger to be doing construction in their states. I don't know how many states. So all the six flyovers we are doing at the same time by Julius Berger and the federal government routes, what it means is that we are doing it at our own cost. Well, let the people know that you say you are not going to refund if we do it. Derivation. So it is very important, very key. And I've told minister, the only way you can encourage states, because these are projects that you are supposed to do for the states. And if you don't say, look, because of lack of funds, the federal government cannot carry out this at the same time. And the states have come to see how they can take it and then agree with you that from time to time, we can offset this cost. That will help us a long way. That will help us a long way. It is this spirit of collaboration for mutual development that informs our decision to go on with the construction of six flyovers to resolve the perennial traffic congestions and the problematic intersections of Port Harcourt, Aba Expressway, and the East-West Road, which is a federal road and a responsibility the federal government may not be ready to discharge now. Let me therefore appeal to the federal government to continue to collaborate with state government on road development by allowing states to fix federal roads with an assurance of a refund. Here in River State, we believe in the Chinese saying that if you want to get rich, you must first build the roads. The provision of quality road infrastructure have remained on the top of our development priorities in the last 5.5 years of our government, and will remain so until the end of our tenure. We have consistently dedicated over 30% of our budget annually in the medium-term expenditure framework for the construction of new roads or the reconstruction or maintenance and rehabilitation of existing roads across the state, including federal roads. The result is the unprecedented delivery of close to 900 kilometers of roads, bridges, and flyovers spread across the length and breadth of the state, including some of the far-flung communities such as Opopo and Amdoni that have now been linked by roads for the first time. This is because we understand the pivotal link between road infrastructure development, economic growth, and the progress of our people. Finally, it is hoped that this meeting will restate the centrality of road infrastructure as a development objective, evaluate the implementation of the recommendations of the previous meetings, and define new and innovative approaches for developing national road infrastructure to meet the social and economic objectives of the country. Let me again thank the Minister of Works and Housing and the Chairman House Committee, Chairman Senate Committee on Works, for the positive role they played in ensuring that we get the reform. They have played a role for us to get, but we have not gotten. So, but let me thank them first. At least as they go back now, they will call the appropriate authorities. Why are you keeping their money up to now? I wish to also similarly thank the Federal Controller of Works in Rivers State for its cooperation with the State Ministry of Works and our involvement with federal roads. Let me use the opportunity to say this. Each time we come and we say what COVID pandemic has caused the economy, how it has destroyed the economies of the various states, various countries, but nobody has talked about the advantages of COVID-19. Without COVID-19, many families would have scattered. COVID-19 has united families. Men now stay at home. So nobody wants to talk about advantages of that. But if this COVID-19 was not there, most families would have been destroyed. So while we talk about disadvantages, also talk about some advantages. On this note, it is my pleasure to declare the 26th meeting of the National Council of Works formally open. Once again, I wish you all fruitful deliberations. Thank you and God bless you.
Hey, this man.